you all come out. Come out of your seats. Come to the front. Let's be unified in worshiping God on tonight. One body.
One in Christ.
Come on. We are wild women. Unafraid. Untamed. Not holding anything back. Can we declare that on tonight? Because he's a wild, wild God. Say, you are a wild, wild God.
You've done. So I was praying before I got here, and I said, Lord, I am going to a wild women's conference. I'm going to be surrounded by so much estrogen, God. I don't know what I'm going to do. But the Lord said to me, my grace is sufficient for you. So I was praying, and I'm like, God, what do you have for tonight? And I just felt one word came to mind. It was destiny. And I'm like, destiny? Why is that, Lord? And then I thought, like, how could you not be wild? How could you not go crazy when you know what God has planned for you? How could you not go wild and crazy when you know the purposes of God for your life? Sing this next song out, and as we sing this song out, I don't care if you've never heard this song before, just look at the words on the screen and sing these words as a declaration over your life. Allow these words to move through you, through you, through you. Here we go.
No one else can love you like I love you, Lord, because I was made to give you my heart. I was made to bring you joy.
No one else.
I was made to give you my heart. I was made to give you joy.
Yeah, 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 yeah.
destiny. You made me for your glory.
Sing it out.
Now I have a purpose. Now I have a destiny. You made me for your glory.
I want only the congregation to sing it out now. Do you believe it? Now I have a.
Y'all sound good.
I have a destiny.
Come on.
Do you believe it? One more time.
Say that right on this very first night, he's going to make an exchange if you're willing to exchange something. If you're willing to exchange the weight of the cares of this world for the weight of his glory, he will make the exchange with you. And so tonight, I just feel like he's saying, just give me the weights of the world. Give me the weights and the pressures that you've come in with tonight. Give them all. Just lay them at his feet. Lay them all at his feet. And he's going to give you the weight of his glory. Moses said, show me your glory. And the Lord said, I'll allow all my goodness. You'll see all my goodness. That's Hebrew superlative tense. The very best that I have will pass before you. So when Moses asked to see glory, the Lord said, watch me reveal my goodness. And so, Lord, we just thank you that we cast the cares of the world onto you, Lord. We make an exchange. You can have all those cares, all those weights. We're not going to worry about them over the weekend, Lord, or forever. We're not going to worry about them because you, in exchange, have given us the weight of your glory.
The Spirit of the Lord is. Sing it out.
There is freedom. When the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom.
Ha! Come on, won't you take that step and dwell under the shadow of the Almighty tonight? Are you ready to mount up on wings like eagles tonight? Are you ready to run and not tire out? Are you prepared to walk forward and faint not? 'Cause Jesus is by your side. Are you ready? Are you ready to take that next step tonight into your freedom? You wild women, freedom reigns in this place.
Showers of mercy and grace.
Come on, sing that out.
Falling on every face.
There is freedom.
There is freedom.
just a little bit. So I'm going to go out on a limb tonight and share this quick testimony because honestly, I'm not even quite sure about what I personally saw myself. As I was on my way over to the church from work, I said to the Lord, I'm like, Lord, God, I need you to show me a sign of something, Lord. I'm looking for the next level, Lord. I'm ready, Lord. I'm tired of being where I'm at, God. I'm ready for more. And I said, Lord, just show me a sign. So I saw the weirdest thing on my way here. Right before I was getting on 95, I saw a car on fire. I mean, like, this car was an inferno. It was an inferno, guys. I mean, like, I am like, wow, I don't see that every day. There was smoke blazing everywhere. And I'm like, yep, I'm pretty sure I'm looking at a car that's on fire right now. Then get this. I turn away, and I look back, and all I see is smoke, but the car is not even there at all. Now, I can go out on a limb and assume that maybe someone gave me something at work. I don't know, maybe they put something in my drink. Or I can believe that God is actually trying to tell me something about what's going on tonight. And he showed me a car that's on fire. Now, when I think about what I hear, when I hear vehicle, I hear like ministry. And I see a vehicle on fire, a ministry on fire. And I feel like there are some people in this place that is like hearing a call, an invitation from God tonight to step into that next level and be planted somewhere. And I'm not saying it has to be this church, but I just feel like God is providing a release tonight to ministry. There's a call to ministry tonight, a call to pull out the fire, the depths from within. So I just want to release that tonight for those who feel like that's for them. That vehicle of ministry. That ministry that's on fire for God. Yeah. We're going to sing this out. Just sing with me if you can. Who is this King of Glory? Let's admire him tonight.
Who is this, the King of Glory? Who is this, the King of Glory? Who is this, the King of Glory?
Reveal yourself tonight, Lord. Come on, set things in motion, God. Who is this?
More to you than meets the eye. There's
so much more, there's so much more. You're more than meets the eye. There's so much more to you, God. So we just ask you tonight, oh God, reveal more. A deeper invitation.
We declare that.
drip down, let it drip down.
Let it 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 drip, let it drip, let it drip, let it drip.
Like a hurricane, I am a tree bending beneath. You know, let's sing it out.
The weight of his wisdom, mercy. When all of a sudden I am unaware of these afflictions, lifts my glory, and I realize just how beautiful you are, and how great your affections are for me.
Thank you for your love. Thank you for your love. aren't you thankful for the love of Jesus tonight? Aren't you thankful to be in this place where the love of Jesus is so profound, where the love of Jesus is so strong? This is a house of love. This is a safe place where we thank you. As we transition, I want to give you one thing that I heard from the Lord a while ago. And I heard him ask you a question. And the question is, are you ready to take a walk on the wild side? Are you ready to take a walk on the wild side? Because we're about to get wild. Things are about to get really wild and crazy. Amen? Amen. You all can be seated. We're going to transition as hard as it is. Getting lost in the gaze of your eyes. I could just get lost in that. Okay, we have, I need everyone to pay attention to what I'm about to say. There is a Mercedes station wagon parked by Subway with your lights on. That you? Okay. Amen. Can I just ask how many of this is your first time here at Redemption or to, oh, wow. You all are in for a treat. It's going to get wild. Amen. All right, we're going to transition. We'll introduce the lovely Donna Shambach.
Come on, let's give it up for Jesus. He's strong in this house, isn't he? So good. Isn't it awesome to have a place to come in off the street and just get settled in our hearts and minds and safe place, as we've heard. And then you hear the Lord say, all that stuff you've been dealing with this week, all the family issues, all the work stuff, all the attacks we talk about so often, just lay them down. Lay them on my altar and don't even think about picking them back up again. And you can make an exchange for the glory. Wow, what a word. Wasn't that awesome? I'm looking forward to hearing Patricia King. How about you? This woman is dear to my heart because of who she is. She walks in the glory. She walks in love. She walks in integrity. And I'm just so proud to know her. And I know that the word that she has carried with her, every one of us needs to hear, amen? I don't know about you, but my heart has been burdened for this generation. I see so many of those that are walking in this generation without any knowledge of God. They have a big empty spot on the inside. They need to know him. And God wants to connect them to his truth. God's putting his hand on his church. We have to understand that part of the destiny that's being released in us, it's a call to touch this generation. And I want to read today because I want to talk about how every generation is called to act. Every generation, you know, even though things can be passed down in our lineage, every one of us is called to pick up the baton for ourselves. We hear a lot about mantles falling on people. I'm not so sure I believe in that. I believe in picking up a mantle. I believe in picking up a responsibility that God is directing us to. And in Genesis chapter 26, there's a story of Isaac. Isaac was the son of promise. Isaac was the one that Abraham hadn't seen. It took him 100 years of faith walking to actually see Isaac. And yet when Abraham was gone, Isaac just couldn't claim the faith of his daddy. You can read it here in Genesis chapter 26. The Bible says there was great famine in the land. And everybody was going down to Egypt for help. If we look through scripture, we'll see that there was a famine in Abraham's time. And Abraham went down to Egypt. And God took care of him in Egypt. But when it came to Isaac, God had something for him to learn. God had a truth that he wanted to bear into Isaac's spirit. Because you see, when it comes to trusting God, it's not always convenient, is it? Abram had a trust without seeing, and Isaac did too. And the Bible said that when he heard the voice of God, God said, I want you to stay right in this land. I want you to stay in this land that's suffering, this land that's dry, this land where there's no touch of rain on it. And the Bible said it was in that land that Isaac began to sow. You know, we think of sowing as something that's just easy to do. It just comes from our person. But anybody who's ever worked on a farm, you know, sowing has a whole lot of preparation, doesn't it? There's got to be a lot of digging of hard ground. There's got to be a lot of weeding. There's a lot of work that goes along with sowing. And I often think about this story. What were Isaac's men thinking about him? They must have thought he lost his mind. You're going to sow in this ground? You're going to sow in this place? But I believe that God was bringing Isaac into a supernatural relationship with him. A relationship that was going to be understood through faith. That it wasn't the hand of man that brought him a blessing, but it was God himself that caused the rain to fall. Amen? I want you to think about this. You know, we don't hear a lot about Isaac doing great exploits to God. But if Isaac had not learned to trust God with faith, if Isaac hadn't sowed, then there would have been a generation that missed out. There would have been no Israel. And so sometimes when we sow, we think, my offering doesn't mean anything. It's just throwing something in a bucket. But I believe in this day and age, God is saying to us, there is a way that you can sow where you can touch me for this generation. And that's what I want to challenge you with tonight. I want you to think about those in your family that still don't know the Lord. How many of you have sons or grandchildren that are away from God and don't want anything to do with them? Lift your hand. I have people in my family that I'm trusting God for. When I sow, I'm going to sow and say, God, whatever I put into the ground, let it count for harvest in this generation. Let us reap a harvest of souls, God. I don't want to just throw money at you. But when I give, I want to sow and expect just what Isaac got. What did he get? 100-fold return in the same year. Now, I don't know that Isaac understood what God was going to do through him. But because he took the step of faith, God gave him perpetual blessing. And he gave him another blessing, too. You know the story. You read on in Genesis chapter 6. He needed water to water his flocks. And he didn't have any. He had to start digging. And when he started to dig, he found Isaac's wells. Abraham's wells. He tapped into something that the generation before had. And this, I believe that this is significant for us too, that when we say, God, this generation needs a move of your spirit. This generation needs what our grandparents had. This generation needs a touch of fire. That God will say, I'm not only going to give you what your grandparents had, but I'm going to give you something they never had. Hallelujah! There's going to be a release of the anointing of God in this generation. So when you sow, you know, I think it's a good thing. Unless God spoke to you, I want you to give this amount. It's a good thing to wait and hear. What would you have me give, Lord, that would be significant as a seed for this generation? Would you mind bowing your heads? Let's listen to God. Father, I thank you for this conference, my first time here. I thank you for the people of God that are present who love you, the worship that's gone up. Father, I ask you that you would give us an amount, just write an amount on our hearts, Lord, that would be a significant amount, that you would say that you were touched by that offering tonight, God. I ask you, Father, that in every family, in everyone that sows in faith, we'll begin to see a release of heaven's bounty, Lord, on our children, on our family members, on this generation, God. Lord, we're seeding not just for this revival, but we're seeding for a generation that needs to know you. God, we're seeding for a reformation revival in the mighty name of Jesus. Everybody said? Amen. Take a few minutes to prepare your offering. And then when you're ready to give, just let me know by standing to your feet. Ushers, you can come. Bring those baskets up here. I understand that the way that we sow is to come and bring an offering to the Lord. When you're ready, come on down. Come and sow for this generation. Cities, Lord. Sowing in faith, God. We're going to reap in this generation. We will pass on a heritage, Father. We will pass on a heritage. Just standing, changing your position one more time. Stand to your feet. Stretch your hands this way. I'm going to lay my hand over one of these. Come on, let's just intercede for this generation. Would you do it? Come on, out loud and on purpose. Pray in English. Pray in your native tongue. Pray in the Holy Ghost. Come on, lift up an intercessory prayer right now. Father, for sons and daughters and grandchildren, nephews, nieces, and brothers and sisters, we ask you, God, that you would take these gifts as seed to be sown. We're asking you for an explosive harvest, God. Turn the tide of this generation, Lord. Let us begin to see it. Lord, even this night, let us begin to see the results. We thank you, God, that your glory waits this offering for the purposes of your kingdom. Give the Lord a hand clap of praise tonight. Come on, bless him. Shout for revival.
Welcome, everybody. This is so exciting. And some of you, to see you guys, I haven't seen some of you maybe for a couple months or something. So it's really exciting to see you guys. Thank you for coming out. Thank you for being part of Wild Women. This is our second year. Our Wild Women is a biannual gathering that we do every 2 years based on a prophecy that was given by Julie Myers, which was pretty amazing. But I'm not going to go into all that right now. because I'm excited about some other things that God wants to do. One thing I would like to do is let everyone know we have child care the whole weekend, 0 to 6 years of age. We do not have it for Saturday afternoon. It will be Friday morning at 10, Friday at 7, Saturday at 10, Saturday night at 7, and then Sunday we have our regular Sunday school. So all up front here, so this is the front of the church. For those that don't know that, a lot of people come in the back of the church, but either way is good. Up front is our coffee bar, and anyone that gets anything from the coffee bar, it goes into a missions account. It goes toward, we have housing missions for America that we house several people, and occasionally, if it's needed, or we take and go on missions trips, and it goes towards that. So we are going on a missions trip to India in the end of January through February 10th. So for those that would like to go, we're given a lot of notice. And is Teresa Bader here tonight? I don't know if she's here, but I don't know if she's here tonight, but you can see me if you're interested in going to that. Let me see what else. The bookstore has a lot of good stuff. So when these speakers are sharing, you guys can take all of them home with you by their product. And it's open an hour before each service and an hour after each service. Okay? I'm getting ready to say that. My husband. How many know that he loves to help me? So if you go out the back doors like you're going to the restroom, the bookstore is the first door on the left. So it will be open an hour after service as well. I want to thank all of our men. I want to thank you, honey. So I want to thank all of our men for coming out to serve, because when we do our women's gatherings, the men do everything. They even clean the church. So we're all about life skills wherever we go. So we're teaching our men to clean. No. Yes. I think we need to have 6 a year. No. So I'm just kidding. Okay. So let me see. We have a Glen Burnie House of Prayer here, which you people that live close in the area, and if you're ever in the area, it's a Monday. A Monday, a Wednesday, and a Thursday is when it's open right now, 10 to 2. Our goal is to eventually have 24-hour prayer. But how many people know, in order to do that, you need to have help? So say if you can help, say ask the Lord. If you're close in the area and maybe you'd like to start stepping out and being part of that and helping, that would be awesome. We also have a prayer line that is a 12-hour prayer line. God, I mean, the reason sometimes people don't want people to know who they are when they want prayer. And that's okay. You know, I want you to know that that's okay. There's many prayer lines out there. So if there is something that you just need to talk about or get prayer for, we offer a prayer line. There's many other prayer lines out there. You can go and look them up and just call them. Those people are there to pray. They're there to pray for you. And there's been some great prayer times that I've had on a prayer line. I was one of those people who didn't want people to know who I was. I just put myself under the bus. Okay. Huh? Oh, I don't call it my prayer line. I'm not that crazy. No, I'm just kidding. So we're here to be wild. And, you know, I was at first, I was like, Lord, you know, wild women, like, so a lot of us just really, to be wild, it's really just, sometimes it's really just doing something that takes us out of our comfort zone. It's so important getting out there. Sometimes, like, people are like, I don't, you know, want to talk to people, you know? You're like for instance, okay, for me, I can talk to anybody. I used to kick in crack doors, had no problem doing it to get people saved. I mean, I'm just being serious because I knew where all the areas were. I knew where all the houses were because of my testimony, so I knew who to go back and who to pull out. But I have fear in other areas that God's still bringing me out of. You know, so all of us are in different places, and the Lord's still faithful to continue the good work that he started in each one of us. So we, you know, ladies, be wild. Don't compare yourself one to another. We're all in a different walk with our daddy, and our daddy's bringing us all through because he is faithful. You know, come on, come on. So I don't know about the rest of my announcements right now because I'm feeling pretty ornery up here. So I think there's an ornery anointing, Patricia. So no, not yet. I got some good things to say about you. So I wrote it down so I wouldn't forget. So we have... there's a connect table in the front and the back of our church. It has a lot of information on it. If there's anything you want to know, you can go there. but I get, woo, I'm really hot. Come on, fire of God. So how many know it's okay to be nervous to introduce somebody? Right? It is. I'll be honest. I mean, you know, this is a great honor to introduce Patricia King. So Patricia King, for those that don't know, she's apostolic leader to many, and with that there's an anointing that I've paid attention to under services and places I've gone and been under. Can I be real about something? You won't hold it against me. Okay. Afterwards, right? Okay. So when I first heard Patricia speak, I was like, I cannot listen to that. I don't know what's going on. This was when I first heard you speak, okay? And I always wanted to go to things that were in my comfort zone when people spoke. Things I was familiar with. Okay? And then because in there I felt secure. Okay? Because of her being apostolic, it challenged me. It challenged me, you know? I didn't know how to handle that. I'm good with most challenges. But I didn't know how to handle that challenge in the spirit. And one time I went in and we sat there, and I mean I would still come, you know, I'd just be like, what am I doing here? You know? And the Lord said, it's exactly what you need. It's exactly what you need. And I was like, ah! And I weeped, you know, and I was like, I still don't understand what that means. It's exactly what I need. Like, I still didn't understand at the time what that meant, you know. But then more and more, I knew that the Lord wanted me there, and I felt absolutely in love with you at Life Center, like, a couple years back. So basically, I was trying to fight against what God was really saying was important for my life. And a lot of times, for some reason, I don't know about all of you, but I know several ladies and myself, you know, we do that, you know? And I'm not sure why we do that. But if we could recognize it a lot sooner, it would get us a lot closer to where we need to be a lot quicker, you know? So I wish I would have recognized it a lot sooner, you know? So now I get all excited when I get to come and I'd be under your mantle and hear you and all that. So don't hold that against me. Okay. So she has anointing to break bondages by the power of words. Her rewards are great. She's a soul winner. And it's so amazing because those that win souls is wise, the Bible says. But what I learned is she transforms lives. So, you know, it's not only in soul winning, but it's in soul keeping. And she establishes the soul keeping, you know, the spirit growing and how we can live it out. She teaches us how to walk it out, live it out just by what she brings. And some of you that never heard her tonight, or if you have heard her, you're getting ready to understand what I'm saying, okay? And let's see. She's not only all that, on top of it, she puts a little icing on the cake. She's a business owner. She's an online mentor. She's an author. She's a TV host. She's a wife. She's She's a mother to many, and she does all this in balancing her life, which is something I need. Tremendously! You stop it! You stop it! You stop it! Okay. I know I'm never going to live this one down. So, okay. But what the greatest thing that I love is that she really is an example of how our dreams can live. They really can live. If you look at one person that fell in love with Jesus, that just went for it, you know, and just didn't stop in anything that God told her to do. And I don't know, I don't know everything, or not maybe not even half of anything, but I just know in my spirit, like what I'm saying, that there's truth and there's weight on it. And so she teaches how to live out our dreams. And so I'm honored to be able to introduce her as a wild woman for Jesus. So, if everybody could please stand and welcome Patricia King.
Wow. That was the most dramatic introduction I've ever had. That was amazing. I loved it. Don't you just love Tracy? She just gives you permission. She gives you permission to be you. And it's so beautiful. You just unlock us and say, yes, we can be wild because Tracy's wild. Crazy in love with Jesus. Amen. I love it. I so do appreciate you and the heart, you know, your heart, the heart of your husband, the church, all your leadership here, for the way that you reach out to those in need, to those who are hungry for God, and you just go seek them out and find them and love on them. It's so beautiful, and I boast on you in a lot of places I go. I love churches that have just a heart to reach out beyond themselves, right? It's just so Jesus. Amen. And it's so good to be with my good friend, Donna Schombach. Oh, you're in for such a treat this weekend. I wish I was going to be here for the whole weekend just to sit under her ministry, because she's so anointed of God. And again, a person with such a golden heart, such a big heart. And this summer, she's going to be probably sharing more about this with you, but she's going right into one of the most dangerous areas in Chicago and setting up tent meetings. She has rallied together pastors to work together that don't usually work together. That's a foreign language to them. But she's gathering them together to win that community. And this is where some of the most lawlessness is in the whole area. And the elder of the community, and she'll probably fill you in, you know, in on all the details, but he's like the mayor of the area. He's given her all kinds of concessions, like for security and that. And he's not even saved. You know, he lives in a homosexual lifestyle, but God's given him favor for Donna and what she's doing there. Very, very excited about that. It'll be a powerful 10 days of meetings, you know, we're going to reach out. And that's how you can transform a region. I mean, those people that are in the gangs, I've actually been in probably that area, or one of those areas down there. And the night that we were down doing ministry, the police were saying, get off the streets. This is very, very, very dangerous. Get off the streets. Even the local people were off the streets because the gangs are so dangerous and life-threatening. And they don't hesitate to shoot you. And you have to know that you are in the Lord, right? Can you imagine living in that darkness? Can you imagine living in that oppression day by day? And some of them, they just can't get out. But Jesus can get in, right? Jesus can get in and transform it. And so you're my hero. And we got kicked out of India together. You were saying that you're going to India. We got kicked out of India together for preaching the gospel. It was such an honor. It was very, very dramatic, and I have to say it was exciting. So Anyways, life is exciting with Jesus. And you know what the Lord says? That when you're persecuted for the sake of righteousness, then your reward in heaven is great. And you get to go out and have all this fun with, you know, pressure coming against you and everything. And then it just stocks up reward for you, you know, that you don't have to do anything for except have people come against you. So if you've got people against you and your faith, guess what? They're building reward for you. So, and it says, great is your reward in heaven. Isn't that nice? Well, I want to give away some gifts tonight. And we have some resource for you at the back table, but I want to give a bunch away to you right now. I love the decrees of the Word of God. The Word doesn't return void. It accomplishes everything it's sent to do. So this is our decree book that's got decrees in it for almost every area of your life. And you can get it on Kindle as well if you want to carry it around in your phone with you. But this is a great tool for prayer, for devotion. We also have 7 decrees for 7 days. Because I hear people say, you know, I don't know if I have time to decree. I thought, you've got time to decree. And so I made this little booklet, 7 decrees for 7 days. So for every day of the week, there are 7 decrees for 7 areas of your life. It takes you only 2 minutes to decree these over your life. Only 2 minutes. And so if you put this at your bedside, and the first thing you do when you get up in the morning is you decree, you put the word forth into your day. Put it forth over your family, you know. Just don't even get out of bed till you make your decrees, right? I've got mine on my phone. I just pick up my phone and decree. Don't even get out of bed before you send the word forth ahead of you, right? And then when you go to bed at night, it's still on your bedside table. Pick it up again and decree it into your night. Amen? So anyways, this is a great tool. And here's a decree for financial breakthrough. God doesn't want one in his kingdom to be poor. Not one. He wants us all to live an abundant life. And so these are decrees for financial breakthrough. God's Law of Attraction. I love this book. This is one of my favorites. It's like however you align your soul, your mind, which includes your thoughts, your imaginations, your emotions, your feelings, and your choices, will attract what you're believing for good or for evil. In 3 John chapter 1, verse 2, it says, Beloved, I pray that in every respect you will prosper and be in health as your soul prospers. And so that is a biblical law, God's law of attraction, or the law of affinity. It's actually a scientific law, and it works for all the people all the time, whether you're a Christian or not a Christian. But we should discover it before anyone else because it's in the Word, right? So as you align your life with the Word of God, you'll attract to your life the Word of God. You'll attract what you are believing in your core. So this teaches you how to partner with God on aligning your soul. You can change your whole life by operating and functioning in that law. And then this one is only for those of you who are over 50. And this is God's anti-aging plan. And, you know, society has just twisted the whole thing about aging, right? The devil doesn't want us to bear fruit in our old age. He doesn't want the latter glory of our house to be greater than the former. And so he spreads these lies into society saying, oh, those, you know, senior citizens are, you know, old. And people are even saying in the church, don't call me a senior citizen because I don't want to be associated with old. I thought, why wouldn't you want to be associated with old? Why not? It's because we don't understand the glory of it. We don't understand the glory of it and the invitation God has given to us. You know, if you were invited to be the senior executive of a corporation, would you despise that? Would you say, oh my gosh, don't call me senior. Don't call me senior. No, you would get it carved out on a nameplate and put on your door, on your desk, on your letterhead, on your business cards. You would put senior executive, you know, of this corporation. What about senior pastor? Would anyone shun that? Oh, don't call me senior. Please don't call me senior. You know, that is an honor. That is an honor to be called a senior pastor. And why do we not take the same honor for being senior citizens? Why don't we? Because we've been lied to. And because we think that as we get older, we're going to deteriorate. and we're going to dwindle, and we're going to lose functionality in body, soul, and spirit. And that is a lie. Amen? It's a lie. And our latter glory of the house is greater than the former. And so that's what God's anti-aging plan is all about. So do you want to give these out to whoever you feel led? Just throw them out then real quick, or it'll take all night. Just throw them out. Yeah, just throw them out. See who'll catch them. That was the wildest resource giveaway I've ever been in. Okay. There's something wild about this meeting. Amen. Okay, here's another wild thing. I'm going to give you all a gift. Every single one of you can have this if you want it. I love mentoring. I have an online mentorship program called the A-Team, where I prepare curriculum every single month that pertains to your spiritual growth, gives you keys on how to access the promises of God, and makes your core strong. Because if your core is strong, if the core of your soul is strengthened in the Lord, then everything that you put your hand to is going to prosper. And if things come against you in life, you're not going to waver, you're not going to lose it. You're going to be strong, immovable, right? And so that's my heart for the A-Team. It is to access, activate, and accelerate your full potential. And so every month I prepare these courses. We have a closed Facebook group where I contribute almost every single day of the month. And then we have Q&A sessions. And we just have a wonderful time in this mentorship. And anyone can join it. It's online. You can just go to patriciakingmentor.com if you want more information about it. But tonight, I want to give you a free course on how to empower your seer anointing. How many of you want to see in the Spirit? You want to see in the Spirit? So this is a whole course. It includes the videos. It includes the notes and the activations, okay? So this is how you get it. You text this number. So you get on your phones, and in the place where you dial the number, you put 22828. 22828. Just text that 22828. And then in the message line on your text, just put Patricia. You're going to send Patricia a text. And then push the little send button. I think it's all lowercase. It might not even be case sensitive. Or it could be the capital P. Capital P. Okay, Patricia. Nothing after the name. Just put Patricia in the message line and then push your send button. And what it'll do is it'll send you a notification back for your email, and it'll send you the course right to your email address. The link will be there with everything that you need, so that when you get home tonight, you can have that, and that's your course to enjoy. And may it really help you develop in the seer anointing. This month in the A-Team, we've been studying keys to confidence, how to build your confidence. And then next month, it's going to be how to mentor others. How many of you actually have felt from the Lord a mentorship anointing on your life? Because that's what he's oiling right now. And so he is oiling us to receive mentoring, to receive growth, and then to become mentors. And do you know how the whole world's going to be discipled? Through us all mentoring those around us. So I'm very, very committed. I'm very committed to seeing the body strengthened so that you can all be good disciples of those coming in to know the Lord. Amen. Well, tonight, you know, earlier in the service, we had a word during worship about destiny. And that's what my word is tonight, is basically, I believe all of you in this next season are going to be stepping into a further engagement of what God has created you for. And it's all about how you say yes to what he's speaking to your heart, okay? And it's just one little step at a time and one invitation at a time. And every time you say yes to an invitation of the Spirit, you're going to step further into the fulfillment of destiny. And what I want to do is look at two examples in Scripture, and then I'm going to give you, we're going to have some fun tonight with some testimonies. And what I want to do is look, first of all, at Deborah. Now, Deborah was a prophetess in a day when Israel was naughty. I mean, they had been doing evil in the sight of God. So think about this, a naughty society full of rebellion and pride and conflict and, you know, I mean, it was, I mean, wherever you've got naughtiness, you're going to have everything else that goes with it too, a bunch of oppression and grunge, and it's just not a happy place to be, okay? So that's what it was like in that day. So God, he puts his hand on Deborah. Now, how many of you know that when God puts his hand on you, you have to respond to it? Just because he puts his hand on you doesn't mean you're going to walk it out. There has to be a yes to that call. When Jesus called his 12 disciples, they all had to get up and follow him. Even though he had his hand on them for that purpose, he chose them, they had to get up and follow him. So imagine being Deborah. I mean, talk about a wild woman, okay? She's living in this dark day when everyone's rebellious, the men are rebellious, they're rebelling against God, doing evil in his sight. So there's probably all kinds of pernicious evil in society. And God says, hey, Deborah, I want you to be the judge and the prophetess in this hour. I'm appointing you to be the judge and the prophetess. Well, I don't know about you, but I think most people would want to shun that. Because it's hard enough trying to lead a rebellious people. But she was a woman too. Okay, and in that day, I mean, there's not many examples in the Bible, but there are examples of women leaders. We see Esther was one, Deborah especially. Those two in the Old Testament are my favorites. But when you look at what Deborah must have gone through, and she was married to Lapidoth, she was a wife, she was a prophetess, and she was a judge. And she said yes, and she judged well. And she prophesied well. And one day, the Lord gives her a word to give to Barak, who is the captain in charge of the army of Israel. And she gives him this word, saying that he's to go out into battle because the Lord's going to give him Sisera. He's going to give him the neck of his enemy. Okay? So Barak responds in Judges 4. He responds and says, if you go with me in the battle, I will go. But if you do not go with me, I will not go. Now, I just want to clear this up if anyone still has a little bit of weirdness on that scripture. Barak didn't disqualify himself by saying he was taking a woman into battle. Okay? I've heard that preached many places. They say, Barak didn't get the honor in the battle. It was given to a woman because he wouldn't go into the battle without a woman. And that is not right. That is not the right explanation. The reason why he wanted Deborah in the battle was, number one, she was righteous. But she was the prophetess of the nation. And he wouldn't go into battle without the word of the Lord. And back in those days, only the prophets carried the word of the Lord. So he was saying, I'm not going to go into battle without you. Now, she could have said no. She could have said no. She said, I'm sorry, I'm going to stay under my palm tree, and I'll prophesy here. You go out. That's your job. You go out into battle. But she said yes. And her yes took her into battle. Now, imagine that. This one woman, this one wild woman who knew God in the midst of all the men that are out there ready to fight. And she's out there, and Barak is waiting for the word of the Lord. And she brings him the word and says, okay, now is the time. Do it now. And he responded to her, and they go out, and they you know, it was a great, it was a great win. Sisera jumps off his horse and gets, you know, running away. And then another woman said yes to the tent peg anointing. I And it's a good thing she said yes. And I don't know about you, but think about it, really, you know. Her husband and Sisera had a covenant together, a covenant of peace. In other words, they were supposed to protect each other. But she was obeying God. God prompted her to put the tent peg in. That took a lot of courage. That took a great big yes. But you see, that's what Deborah had prophesied. She said, the battle will, you know, the honor of the battle, Barak, is not going to be given to you. It's going to be given to a woman. Barak could have cared less if the honor was given to him. He was a secure man. He just wanted God to get the honor, and that's all we should all be. He didn't care that it was a woman. All Deborah was doing was prophesying. God wasn't punishing Barak. Deborah was just prophesying, saying, this is how the battle is going to go. And because he was the captain of the army, he had to ensure that the will of God was done according to the word of the Lord. And so he followed it all the way through, and he found Sisera. He found, you know, Jael. He saw that the woman had taken him down. So he knew that the will of God was done. So him and Deborah together sang the song, okay? The song of victory was sung by them both. Barak sometimes gets such a bad rap as being this wimpy guy. He was not. He was the captain of the army of Israel. You don't get that position by being a wimp. That's a seasoned position. But also in Hebrews 11, where it talks about the heroes of faith, guess who's there? He's numbered with the heroes of faith. And he was not afraid to say yes to God. And neither was Deborah, and neither was Jael. And their yes produced a destiny position for the nation of Israel in their day. Just three people's yes produced a victory for the nation. Your yes can bring forth an established destiny victory for your nation, for your region. Don't think small of this. This is amazing. Here's another one. Look at Mary. In Luke chapter 1, Gabriel comes to Mary and says, hey, hail Mary, you're a favored one. You know, ta-da. Guess what, Mary? You've been chosen. You're going to have a baby. And he's going to be the Messiah. He's going to be the Savior of the world. And she says, whoa, just a minute. I've not been with a man. I'm not married yet. I'm engaged, but I'm not married yet. And I've not been with a man. And he said, and how can this be? And the angel responded back to her. And by the way, isn't it interesting that she's dialoguing with the angel? She didn't go ask God about it. She just was dialoguing with the angel. I thought that was interesting. But the angel said, well, the Spirit of God is going to come upon you. And the conception will be of the Spirit of God. So when Mary heard the will of God, she said yes. She said, let it be done unto me according to your will. She was not prepared. I mean, who would have been prepared to raise Jesus? That's just a little bit of a heavy mantle. Who would have had the preparation? She was only a girl of about probably 14 years of age when she gave birth to Jesus. That is something else, isn't it? And it must have been in some ways terrifying, confusing to her. Like, how's this going to work out? What are people going to think of me? Because are they going to believe that the Holy Spirit came upon me? You know, or are they going to think I'm just making it up? Come on, let's get real here. Let's put ourselves right inside of these people's lives, because, you know, they're not separate from how we would live our life. They're like you and I. And but she said yes. And that yes brought an enablement to her that produced a destiny that not only preserved a nation, but established the kingdom of God through her, right? And so your yes to God can produce great things. Now, I don't think Deborah realized when she said yes to God and to the calling how significant her ministry was going to be. I don't think Mary understood when she said yes to God how significant her life was going to be. And I don't think you realize how significant your life is when you say yes to God. And it's just everything is a step forward with a yes. The next step forward with a yes. The next step forward with a yes. So I want to share with you some stories of my life and some of the areas where I said yes, not knowing, you know, not knowing what was going to happen. And the first yes that we probably all said to God was when we were born again. The night that he came into my life, I was so dark. I was so thrashed, beaten up, depressed, evil within. You know, I was just so discouraged with myself. I didn't think I was fit to have God come and live inside of me. But I'd heard some people give their testimony of Jesus coming into their life, forgiving them their sin, and making them a new person. And I thought, Jesus, I would really like that. I didn't know how to pray. I just knew that he was stirring my heart. I'd been at this prayer meeting where everyone shared their testimony, and I could feel the draw, and that was the Spirit of God drawing. And I wrestled with it because I thought, well, Lord, I don't have anything good to give you. I'm just a mess. There's nothing good inside of me. There's nothing I have to offer. And I just began to weep. And I said, if you'd like to come in, I'd really like you to come in. And I said yes to that knocking on the door of my heart. I said yes. And he didn't hesitate. He came in like liquid love. It felt like liquid love. I know now that that's the glory of God. And he removed my sin. I actually felt the guilt, the shame, everything I'd lived with for years. It was all lifted off, and I felt so new and so clean and so loved inside. And that was produced by a yes. Every time God knocks on your heart, it'll bring you into destiny. So I said yes. I didn't realize then. I was in my mid-20s. I've been born again for over 43 years now. I did not realize that my life was going to be what it is today. But on that day, everything changed. The direction of my life changed. My decisions changed. That one yes changed everything. I can't even imagine where I would be today if I hadn't said yes back then. I would be on a totally different path, and so would you, right? But because you said yes, you started stepping into destiny. The same happened to me when I was invited by the Spirit of God as a brand new believer. I was 3 days old in the Lord, and someone gave me the book about Holy Spirit, Good Morning, Holy Spirit. And I read the book, and I got hungry for this baptism with the Holy Spirit. I read the second book, and at the end, there was a prayer someone had put in there. I prayed the prayer and responded. I just responded to the call of the Holy Spirit to be filled with Holy Spirit, and that changed my life again. I started speaking in tongues that day, and that changed my life, saying yes to God, saying yes. Every yes you say will bring you a step forward. And so we went, you know, just kept moving forward. He put, you know, just passion in my heart for the lost. I'd go out on the streets and pass out tracts and tell people about Jesus. And it was so amazing. I just loved it. Every time I had the nudge, I would say yes. I just get these ideas, these God ideas would come in. I said, sure, let's do it. I remember when my boys were just young, you know, because they were babies when I got saved. And I would put them down for a sleep in the afternoon. And I said, oh, God, you know, what can I do? And he'd give me an idea to phone people in the telephone book. We had telephone books back then. And you could look up numbers. And I would just call people randomly in the telephone book while my kids were sleeping. Would you like to receive Jesus? And other times, you know, the Holy Spirit would say, put your boys in the backseat of the car and go for a drive. And I'm going to lead you to a hitchhiker. I want you to take him wherever he goes and lead him to me. Wherever he wants to go, take him there. And so I would do things like that often. They were just saying yes to the nudges of the Spirit. Just those little internal nudges that he gives you, those little invitations. I didn't know where that was going to lead me. I didn't even know anything about the future. I just knew that I was crazy in love with Jesus at the moment. And that if he put a little idea in there, a little nudge in there, I was just going to go for it. And little did I know that that yes, after yes, after yes, was putting me on a path with him that I had no idea how glorious it would be. And your little yeses are going to lead you into a glorious place. I remember the very first time that I went out to preach. And, you know, sometimes you just have to say your yes and then worry about everything. Or don't even worry about it. Just, you know, cast your care onto God and just let her rip, okay? But my friend and I had been trained in the gifts of the Holy Spirit. Our church had hosted a teacher to come in and teach on the gifts. So every Tuesday night for 5 or 6 months, we were there getting trained and activated and everything. We loved it. And so in our prayer meetings, you know, and, you know, church meetings and that, we would prophesy and get words of knowledge and pray for the sick and that. But we weren't super skilled in it. We were just starting. We were just learning. And I received a call one day, and the call was from a Native American gal who lived in the north of Canada. And she said, "We really need your help. We've been planning a crusade in our village for months, for over 6 months. And only my sister and I are the only born-again people in our village. And we've had an evangelist booked to come and do this crusade for almost 6 months. And they just called and said they cannot come. But the crusade is the day after tomorrow. And we don't know what to do." So my teacher, who trained me in the gifts of the Spirit, was on television at the time. So they called her to see if she could come. And she said, "Well, I can't come because of my schedule. But I've got these two gals that I have trained, and they could come." And that's how we got the call. And so they said, "Could you come up here tomorrow?" Now, I've got two little children at home, a husband, and I've never been out on the road before. I've never preached before. And somehow that didn't even cross my mind at the time. I don't know why. I never even thought of it. I think sometimes God just blanks you out, right? And so I said, "Well, I'm going to have to ask my pastor. I'll have to ask my husband." They said, "Well, we can give you like maybe at the most 4 hours to make your decision. We need it right away. But please, please try to come, because we've tried even people up in our local area. Nobody can come. And we just feel so let down." And you could feel their pain, you know. And so we called our pastor and our husbands, and they said yes. In fact, my pastor said, "You don't need three dreams and a vision to go preach the gospel. The Bible tells you to go preach the gospel." So anyways, it took us, I mean, we were rushing around to get meals ready, to get our kids' child care ready, to get everything all ready. So, I mean, we were just working by the hour trying to get everything organized. And we had to leave first thing in the morning to go up there. So we race out the door in the morning, get to the airport, get on the plane, and we're up in the air. And I said to my friend, I said, "Oh my goodness, I've never been an evangelist at a crusade before. Have you?" And she said, "No." And that's when I freaked out. We had said yes and didn't even count the cost. We never even considered what we were doing. That's wild women, you know. And so we're on this plane, and I'm thinking, "Oh my goodness." And I said, "Well, let's just pray in tongues, because our teacher told us that when you pray in tongues, you'll charge up your spiritual battery, and we'll just charge up right now." So we're on the plane, and the flight attendant comes back and says, "Hello, excuse me, would you like something to drink?" "No, thank you." We were scared spitless. We just didn't want to stop praying in tongues because we were afraid to, you know. So then we get to the airport, and we get picked up at the airport by these two beautiful gals that were from the village that we were going to be ministering at. And they said, "Well, we've got, you know, a couple of hour drive." And I thought, "Oh, praise God, that'll give us some more time to pray in tongues." And so, and now we didn't have to whisper it. We could be in the back seat and let her rip, right? So that's what we did. We're in the back seat. Somehow it makes you feel stronger when you can do it loud, right? So we were just letting her rip. And all of a sudden, I saw these two gals up front. They start to freeze up like this, like we're in the back, but I can see them like this, and the gal who's driving is like this, and I thought, oh my gosh, they probably don't know what tongues is. And the Lord said to me, they don't even know who I am yet. I thought, oh, they were just sent to go pick us up. It's a good way to make $50, you know? So we ended up leading them to the Lord. So I said to my friend, well, you know, this isn't bad being an evangelist at a crusade. It's 100% so far, 100% conversion. And then we led them into the baptism with the Holy Spirit and got them speaking in tongues too. So now we're a power car. We're a power car now. So we're motoring down the highway. And we get to the village. By that time, it's night. It's nighttime. And we get to the village, and they take us to the Catholic church. They said, we're supposed to take you to a prayer meeting. I thought, at the time they told us, I thought, prayer meeting, yeah, that's one thing we're good at. We know how to intercede, so this is going to be good. But then they took us to the Catholic church. It wasn't the kind of prayer meeting we were thinking of, right? It was a different kind of prayer meeting. So we're sitting at the back waiting for them to finish the liturgical prayer meeting. And then the man who was leading the meeting said, oh, we have the special evangelists that have come in from the coast. And I turned to my friend. I said, they think that we're evangelists. They don't know that we're just housewives. And he said, come forward and finish the meeting. And I thought, he wants us to take the meeting now. I said to my friend, have you ever taken a meeting? She said, no. And I said, oh. And he said, come on up, you know. And I thought, wow. Now, we had to say yes. Under pressure. It was under pressure. I did not want to say yes, but everybody was looking at us. So we go up there, and we're the only Caucasians in the whole place. I'm really tall and quite a large woman, and my friend is really small. We look like Mutt and Jeff up there, I'm telling you. I didn't know what to do. I never thought about ahead of time how you lead a meeting, what do? And so I thought, well, we might as well start with a greeting. So my friend was actually on this side of me. I said, we just want to greet you from the coast. And, you know, I thought, yeah. And my friend's nodding her head, like, with a big smile. I said, yes, and our pastors would want to greet you. And our husbands, they want to greet you. And I ran out of greetings. I ran out of greetings, and my friend wasn't helping. She was just smiling like, yes. And inside, I'm thinking, what am I going to do now, God? What do I do? What do I do? What do I do? You know? And then all of a sudden, the thought came into my mind. I believe it was the Holy Spirit. He said, just pretend that you're at your Gifts of the Spirit meeting where you activate it. And activate this meeting. Activate. And I thought, okay. I can do that. Okay. I gave him my yes. And so I told my friend, okay, I'm going to get a prophetic word. You get a prophetic word, then I'll get one, and you get one. So, okay. So we were getting words of knowledge and prophecies, and we were just giving them out. I would give one, she would give one. I would give one, she would give one. And we were just, I mean, we were getting in the role, you know? And then I said, okay, if any of you relate to any of those. I mean, we gave out so many words, it would be impossible for there not to be a few people. Especially the one that said, there's someone here with a headache. There's someone here with a lower back. I didn't realize how many headaches people had until then. But, you know, we're just following the Spirit. Just saying, okay, what is it? Headache, okay. Lower back pain, okay. Foot ache, okay. You know, and so we're just saying whatever comes to our mind, we're believing that it's Holy Spirit and doing it very, very simple. But everyone comes up front, almost the whole place. And I thought, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. You see, saying yes to those little nudges brought response. So I said to my friend, you go down that end. I'll go down that end. We'll pray for the people. I'll meet you in the middle. So we went down. And the first person, before I even prayed for them, they went down under the power. Then the next one. And the same was happening to my friend down there. They were all under the power. I think God put them all under the power so we wouldn't mess up. That's what I think. We were feeling pretty powerful. I thought, man, this is easy, you know. So they took us to where we were staying, which was this little log, kind of a log house sort of thing. It was beautiful. And in the morning, first thing in the morning, almost before the sun rises, we get this banging on our door. We answer it, and they said, hey, everyone heard about the healings God did last night. I guess he got up off the floor, and they were healed. And they said, there's some people in the village we need you to come and pray for. So they, all day long, they took us around from house to house in the village, and we were praying for all kinds of different needs in the village. It was just beautiful. We were having such a good time. You know, but we said yes, that we would go with them. You can say no when someone asks you for prayer. You can say, oops, I'm sorry, I'm busy. Oh, you know what? I haven't had enough sleep yet. Come back in 5 hours. You know, you have a choice to say yes, especially when it's uncomfortable for you. But if you'll say yes, you'll go into something with God that is so beautiful. And that whole day was just beautiful. You could feel the presence of God so thick. And so we were having a great time, and I said, you know, we were leading people to the Lord, and we were getting people filled with the Holy Spirit. I mean, people were getting healed, you know, and we were feeling pretty good about ourselves. There was a story someone told me one time that this man was in the forest, and he looked at this woodpecker pecking on a tree, pecking away, thought, wow. That's quite the woodpecker. And then all of a sudden, a lightning bolt comes from heaven and splits a tree in half. And he says, wow, what a beak. We can get so ridiculous sometimes, right? You know, that, you know, you see a few people healed or something, and all of a sudden you think, wow, I'm sure anointed. It's God all the time. He gets all the glory. He gets everything. So at the end of the day, as we're praying for people, the leader of the meeting comes and says, oh, hello, nice to meet you. I'm the leader of the meeting. We're going to take you over to the crusade now. I thought, this wasn't it? I thought this was maybe it, you know? And she said, no, you've got to come with us. We didn't even have time to go back and brush our teeth. They just took us to this meeting, which was this big log building. And there was about 120 people only that came in, but they came over from all over the different areas and different villages, and that was really precious. And it was really fun being out there with them. And they had this band. I don't think it was Christian, but they were singing, Amazing Grace and things like that, but in kind of a country twang, and they were singing different love songs and stuff like that. It was kind of all mixed up. But it was fun. They were all there, you know, happy, and, you know, they were with each other. It was really a beautiful experience to be with them. And then the leader gets up and says, okay, we've got these evangelists from the coast that are here, and they're going to be preaching this weekend. And so I turned to my girlfriend, and I said, that's going to be you tonight, because you've preached before. I've not preached before. And she had preached a couple times before. So I said, you get up and preach. So she's this tiny little girl. Her head is hardly over the pulpit. And she didn't have a message because we didn't have time to prepare. I mean, you know, wow. You know, we were just kind of taken up in the plane and there we were. But we had learned to prophesy by just listening to God for one phrase at a time. It's kind of like a Kleenex box. You pull the tissue out and the next one pops up, right? And if you hear God and speak that first thing that comes to your mind, then he'll give you the next thing. It's a big step of faith, but it's amazing how God uses that. So she had this thought, I'll just preach that way. I prophesied that way. I'll just preach that way. I don't know what I'm going to say, God, but you can give me each phrase at a time. And that's how she preached. And I remember her sermon was so good. And at the end, she had an altar call, and everyone in the place was born again. And over 100 people then got filled with the Holy Spirit. Now, just think about that. What if we had said no? Those people heard the gospel for the very first time. the very first time about being born again and spirit-filled. They had had Catholic churches in their reserves, but they'd never heard about being born again and being spirit-filled. So then we were so excited we could hardly sleep that night. We thought, I think I've died and gone to heaven, right? In the morning, the leader comes and she says, we're really excited about what happened, but she said, today we want you to cast the devils out of everyone because in our villages, they're steeped into witchcraft and they have addictions and suicide and incest, you know, just a few little guys, right? We've never cast a devil out in our life. I'd had some demons cast out of me when I was a new Christian, but I never cast out a devil. And my friend is frozen, and I'm thinking, oh, my gosh, you know, what do we do? What do we do, God? What do we do? And he says, you just do it. And the thought came to me that the Bible, it has stories about demons coming out. So we looked them up. We looked up all the scriptures about the demons coming out. And then our teacher, she had shared about demons coming out when she was ministering. So I said to my friend, this is what we're going to do. We're going to read the Bible stories about the demons coming out. I'll read one, you can read one. I'll read one, you can read one. And we'll make a list of Mary Goddard's stories where she casts the devils out. I'll tell one, you tell one, and we'll go back. And then we're just going to see if anyone has a demon. And then we'll just cast it out. So that's what we did. We read the scriptures, we told the testimony, and then I said, okay, if anyone thinks you've got a demon, come on forward and we will cast it out. And I was scared, you know. I mean, I didn't know what to expect. I thought maybe nobody has a demon. That's pretty scary too, if you just preached on it and no one has one. And then what if they come up and we can't get it out? What if those demons won't listen to us, right? So all this is going through my mind. I say, okay, just come forward if you think you've got a demon. And all of a sudden, all hell broke loose in that place. And I'm not exaggerating when I say we had one gal was wiggling down the aisle like a snake. Her body was contorting like a snake, and she hissed, and her tongue was going in and out. And there was someone over here that fell down on all fours and started howling like a wolf. There's people rolling around on the floor screaming. I mean, the place was a hellhole there for a moment when all these demons were manifesting. And my friend was scared also. Like, we didn't know, like, what do you do with that? You know, the whole place has gone crazy. And I said, okay. We're just going to go to these things that are wiggling, and we're going to command the spirits to come out. So I went to the snake lady. I said, in the name of Jesus Christ, come out. And it was going, you know. And I said, come out, come out, come out in Jesus' name. I mean, I probably didn't do it right and that, but I was just, you know, doing the best I could with what I had. And then the wolf over here, come on, you wolf spirit, get out. I mean, we just assumed it was a wolf spirit. We didn't know. There's witchcraft spirits, every kind of spirit. We spent the whole day casting out devils. They all came out. They came out. People were weeping and crying. And they would hug you and not let go. They were crying. I mean, it was just like the most amazing display of God's love. It was so, so amazing. So what happened is we became famous overnight. Because these people represented different villages that had never heard the gospel before. So they went back to their villages and says, Jesus can fix your addictions, your suicidal tendencies. He can heal your sicknesses, your diseases. He can set you free from anything that ails you. And they became preachers in their villages. So we were getting invitations. They didn't know it was our first time. They thought that we were skilled deliverance ministers. So we got invited back into many different places. I remember one time they rented a public library, the room in the back of the library, on a Saturday to have their meeting. And the demons started manifesting and screaming. blood-curdling screams the demons were making a scene. And the librarian came over. And one of the little gals at the back locked the door so she couldn't get in. She said, "Let me in, let me in." Said, "No." So she called the police, and we had to leave that building. There's all kinds of stuff like that that happened over the following years. We used to take our children up in the summer. It was amazing. We have to go down all these roads and take canoes down rapids and everything to get to remote places that didn't even have roads into them to preach the gospel. And I remember this one that we went to, and it was a glorious time there. There had been a lot of suicides and a lot of incest in that. And we went in there and preached the gospel. And the Catholic Church let us use their building. So we preached the gospel in there, and people were getting saved. The Catholic priest came in, and he said, "What is this?" I said, "This is Jesus." He says, "Whoa, okay." And so he got his bottle of oil out. And I said, "Bless that oil, Lord." And I said, "Look, why don't you put a dab of oil on people?" Because he seemed to think the oil was it. So I blessed the oil. I said, you just put the dab of oil on them and we'll pray. And I prayed, and they would go down under the power and get set free. And it was just glorious. That whole village was impacted. Probably about 80% of the village at least was born again and spirit-filled after that one weekend. Now, the thing that I want to point out to you is that it was just because of a yes. It wasn't because I was a seasoned minister, evangelist. It wasn't because I had all the goods. It wasn't because I had the Bible school education or anything like that. It was just because of a yes in response to a great God that can do all things. It was a few years later after that my friend and I were watching a program called 100 Huntley Street up in Canada, and they were interviewing these two Native men. They're just precious, sharing their testimony and all the miracles that were happening. They were going all across Canada, sharing the gospel in the different reserves across the nation, and they were sharing about all the spectacular things God was doing. I thought, oh, that is so neat. And then the interviewer said, "Well, how did you get born again?" And they said, "Well, it was one summer, these two crazy, wild white women came into our village. And we thought that it was just all a big farce, and we were totally drunk. And our friend said, 'No, come and just feel what God will do.' And they got halfway up the aisle, and the Lord put them down under the power. And they never felt anything like that again. They got saved, filled with the Holy Spirit, delivered in that one weekend. And there they were all across Canada. Now, you see the ripple effect. You see the ripple effect. That yes that led us to that event produced fruit that affected a nation, that affected a whole people group. Your yes is bigger than you understand. It's bigger than you know. And I could go on and on and on and on and tell you, but, you know, the place where we're ministering now, we reach through media 30 million people a month, 30 million people worldwide in all the different nations every single month. How did we get here? By a yes? By a yes? How do we get to influence people? I was talking to my brother yesterday morning because our father passed yesterday morning. And so I was speaking with him, and he was saying, "You know, Patricia, you have no idea how many lives are touched even up here, because in my father's home where he was living, the people were touched, the books got in there." And he just started to weep. He said, "You have just impacted so many people in this region, and you're hardly ever here, right? Because of a yes." So don't underestimate your yes. And I want to just quickly tell you a few other things, is that because you just say yes to every day. You know, my first book, I never ever thought I would write a book. But the Holy Spirit said to me one day, he said, "I want you to write a book on Third Heaven." I said, "But I'm not an author." And he says, "But I am." He said, "I authored the scriptures. And if you will receive the author's anointing from me, you will be able to write." And I just responded to it with a yes. It was a weak yes. I felt inadequate. I didn't feel like I had anything that could produce a book. And I just said, God, I just received that author's anointing from you. Holy Spirit, fill me. And then I sat in front of my computer and out came a book. In no time at all, my first book. Now I've written 72. And you know, I didn't start writing until I was in my 50s. And I'm only 67 now. I'll be turning 67 in June. And I've written 72 books. That's including manuals and co-authored books. But 35 of my own that are all mine, and 72 with everything. In less than 17 years. And it all was because of a yes. That's all. Our ministry in media, I never grew up with a desire to be in media. I had never had any ambition for it, no goals for it. When I became a Christian, no one ever prophesied that over me or anything. I had nothing in me that even thought of media. And one day I'm watching the TV, I'm trying to find something decent to watch. And every channel that I flicked through, I could see all this new age prophetic, just false prophetic. There was spirit mediums and tarot card readers and astrologers and all. I mean, every channel I turned to, and it created this righteous indignation inside. I said, where are your prophets in media? I called forth the media prophets from the north, the south, the east, and the west. We call them forth for your glory, Lord God, to replace the error. And he says, would you do it? And I said, no. Not me. I'm not called to media. He says, will you do it? And I said, no, but I could pray. Now, praise God that he doesn't accept our no right away most of the time. And he just kept massaging it until I said yes. But my yes was weak. I said, I'll tell you what, God. I wouldn't even know how to start with media. I don't know nothing about it. I don't know what to do behind the camera, in front of the camera. I know nothing about media. So you're going to have to give me someone to come along my side to help me with it. And if you bring me that person, then I'll do it. So that was my yes. Hello. That was a pretty feeble yes. Yes, if. Okay. Within 2 weeks, I'm up at Bill Johnson's church. I was preaching at a prophetic conference there. And in the break time, Shirley Seeger comes up to me. It was Shirley Ross back then because she wasn't married yet. And she says, you know, I hardly ever go to a Christian conference. And when I do, I never would think of bothering a speaker during their break. But the Lord told me that I'm supposed to come and tell you who I am, what I do, and I'm supposed to help you with something. She said, my name is Shirley Ross. I've worked in Hollywood as a producer for 22 years, and I'm supposed to help you with something. And we are still producing to this day together. And so I took her out for dinner that night, and we said yes. We said yes, which I thought was only going to be one thing. I just thought we were going to do a special on the prophetic. And it turned out to be, I mean, this is our 15 years now of producing television and airing television programs. And that's not even including all the online media and everything that we're putting our hand to today. It's just a yes. How do we reach 30 million people with the gospel? By a yes. You don't know where your yes is going to take you. I didn't know where the yes was going to take me. I had no idea. We just said yes. Every time God gave an opportunity, we just give him our yes. And like I said, even when I had a no, he's merciful. But he won't strive with you forever. So be careful how many times you give him a no. And let me do one more thing. And then I'm going to give you some keys on how you can position yourself. When I was in my 50s, as I said, I became an author. I became a television producer and a television host. I'd never done any of those things before. And I also became a businesswoman. I was a nurse by profession. I'd never had any business experience or anything. But I was reading the scripture one day where Jesus said, I'm about my Father's business. And the Holy Spirit spoke to me. He said, I want to highlight being about your Father's business. I want to show you how to affect and influence your society through business. And that was before all the Seven Mountain teachings was out there and you know, highlighted. And I said, yes. In fact, I was quite excited about it. Didn't know what it was going to look like. But within that first 2 years, we set up three businesses that were successful. In addition to the ministries that were in the USA, Canada, the UK, New Zealand. Okay? That's where we had the bases at that time. Running those bases plus businesses. And I loved it. And the Holy Spirit just breathed upon it. And I thought, this is how we can transform a nation. So when we went over to Cambodia and found that people were selling their children to the sex traffickers and to the labor traffickers and now to the organ traffickers, that they were selling their children, when we sought the Lord over it, he says, one of the reasons for this is systemic poverty. They need money to feed their children. So what are you going to do about it? And I talked to this one Cambodian woman. I said, would you like to go into business with me? And she said, yes, I would love that. So I went out and I bought a bag of soap and a tub to clean clothes in. I also bought a washer, an electric washer that never got used. She never even took the cellophane off of it because she prefers the bucket. But so a bag of soap and the bucket cost me about $2 or $3. And we started Purity Laundry Services. The Lord had told me to start a new industry called Justice Tourism. I said, what's Justice Tourism? He said, I'm going to have you create an outreach center here, but when they're here to work with my mandate for mercy and for justice, they're going to need things because of tourism. They're going to need coffee. They're going to need foot massages. They're going to need maybe their nails done. They're going to need their clothes washed. And so we set up the Purity Laundry Service, and I went on my computer and made up a price list, and we put it up at the outreach center and said, this is Purity Laundry Service. It's a new business we just started in Poipet, Cambodia. And so if you need your clothes, do it here. And we taught the girls how to pray over the clothing and how to wash it well. And I said, one day you're going to get into the hotels and people are lying on those bed sheets doing naughty things. But we're going to purify the linen. And when they lie on those beds, there's going to be some things they won't be able to do because the righteousness of God will saturate those sheets. And so we just gave her vision for what could happen. And within the first month, she was prospering. The average income, a good income there that could look after the rice for the family at that time was about $60 a month. It would look after a family. And so that was a fairly good income. But she made over $80 in the first month. And then she had to hire help. And now we're in Phnom Penh and we're in different places with Purity Laundry Services. The next one was King's Crown Jewelry Company. And someone gave me a bag of beads. I looked at the bag of beads, and I thought, what are we going to do with this? And I thought, this is a company. This is a business. And we had just rescued a young couple that had been tried to get into Thailand, and the immigration caught them and threw them back, and they were just destitute, totally destitute, and they were all their hope was gone. I said, hey, do you want to go into business? And I brought out the bag of beads. And we prayed over them. They received Jesus Christ as their Savior. And we set them up in a kingdom business the first day they got saved. And they were naturals at making jewelry, you know. And they just made the jewelry. And we sold them to the justice tourists that came into town. And they took these trinkets back with them and, you know, kept the couple in prayer and everything. And again, they created enough work with their jewelry. We taught them how to take the money that they made, go buy more beads, and they ended up hiring three families. Three families were out of poverty because of King's Crown Jewelry. Three families were out of poverty because of Purity Laundry Services. Now, what if we had never said yes? We started breaking systemic poverty through this little thing. And sometimes we think, well, my effort's so little. All my efforts have been little. But God is a big God. And when he breathes on something, it just ripples out. And it has great effect. And you are going to be surprised when you get to glory and you see what the fruit of your yes has produced. You're going to be so amazed, women, at what God has waiting for you when you see the fullness of all that your yes has produced. I just want to encourage you to give God your yes tonight. So here's some steps for you that you can write down. First of all, say yes to Jesus every day. When you wake up in the morning, just say yes to Jesus. Say yes, Jesus. Whatever you want me to do today, I just already say yes. I'll give you my yes ahead of time. Secondly, nurture his life in you. Nurture the yes in you with worship, with prayer, praying in tongues, basking in his presence. Let him and let your yes be soaked. Let it be a seed that is soaked in his glory. And especially like if you've said yes to something from the nudges of his heart into your heart and you've engaged with that and you've said your yes, just take that yes seed and let it germinate. Let it sprout in his glory, in his worship, in his presence. And so nurture that seed of yes in you. Third, take courage. Don't let fear hold you back. One of the biggest things that women face is, what if I do it and fail? What if I step out and try it and fail? Even with evangelism, oftentimes you'll go out on the streets and you'll think, well, what if I approach that person and they reject me? You've got to go with courage, because the thing is, they might reject you. It is totally possible. They might reject you real bad. They might spit on you, call you names, everything. And that will create another opportunity for you to receive the wisdom of God and what to do about it. And when you face hard situations like that and you don't know where to go next, just wait for God to show you and then give him your yes there. Because he will show you the next step. And if you get rejected, he'll show you how to overcome that rejection, because you need courage to say your yes. And what if you put your hand to something that you said yes to and it didn't turn out as glorious as you thought it was going to? You know what? He watched you move. He watched you move forward with your yes. He finds pleasure in you, and you have to keep your courage and keep going. You know, there's a lot of projects. Like, I remember when we first came into Phoenix, Arizona, we were under a lot of opposition. And we would host a meeting for the Glory School, and nobody would show. Nobody would show. There would be like half a dozen people or something. And we would just teach it like there was 100 people in the room or 1,000 people in the room. And we were just faithful. And it makes you not want to do it again when you go through so much and then no one's there and you feel the rejection. The enemy's lying to you, saying, you're no good. That's why no one showed up, is because you're just a creep, you know. And you have to learn how to take courage and say, no, I know this is what God told me to do. And so we'd set up the next meeting. The next time we'd fast and pray for a month. Pray for 3 months into it, but fast and pray for a month before it started. And then that one would produce about 60 people in attendance. And then we had to fight again for 80 people, you know, but we just kept going because we knew that the message that God gave us was to be given out. And it's not to be kept to ourselves, it's to be given to others. And it wasn't about for ourselves, like, you know, that we needed a big crowd or anything, but we needed to be faithful to steward the word with a yes that he gave us. So don't be afraid. You will face things that will be treacherous. Look what happened to Israel when they went into the promised land to spy it out. They said, wow, it's a good land, but it's freaky out there. They've got these big giants that are so big, and we are unable to take them. And right away, they were giving God their no. because they lost their courage. But Joshua and Caleb, men of faith, said, yeah, you know, there are some giants out there, but we're well able to take them. Let's just go for it. And they had to go in faith. And if you don't get it the first time, do it again. Like, I love Walt Disney. I love his story. You know, I mean, Mickey Mouse is so famous and so rich. But Mickey Mouse was a failure. And the first few times that Walt Disney brought him forth. In fact, Walt Disney became bankrupt trying to develop Mickey Mouse. Personal bankruptcy. And then finally someone saw the vision and was able to run with it. And the rest is history. But what if he had said no after the first failure? What if he had said no after the second failure? After the third failure, when he lost all his personal assets, what if he just said, well, I guess the mouse isn't worth it. But we have history today. Children every day are enjoying Mickey Mouse still because someone persevered. And I'm not trying to cheer on Walt Disney productions because there's some stuff there that definitely has to be weeded out. But the principle of giving God your yes. And I did hear that Walt Disney gave his heart to the Lord, by the way, before he passed. Okay, and then the fourth thing. Okay, the first one is say yes every day to whatever nudges the Holy Spirit gives you. Nurture his life in you. Nurture that yes that he gives you in you with the word, with worship, and with prayer. Number three, take courage. Don't let fear hold you back. And number four, step forward in faith. And just take one step of faith at a time. And that step of faith attached to your yes is going to walk you right into fulfillment of destiny. It's just one day at a time, one choice at a time, one decision at a time, one yes at a time. And there's some of you women today that are not wild yet. Because you've been disappointed. And because of people's words over your life, they have scorned you and put you down and, you know, told you that you'll never amount to anything or you can't do it. Some of you have even had spiritual leaders telling you that. You're no good, you can't do that. You're not anointed for it, don't even try. And so you just laid down and you lost your yes. But tonight, God is going to help you find your yes. And I don't know if there's any of the worship team that are available right now, but I'd love to invite you up if you can. Anyone that could just come up. And I want all of you women who identified with that word that you lost your yes. You're not a wild woman. You're not bold for God anymore because of things that hurt you in life. God's going to exchange that. He's going to exchange that weight of care and pain and fear. He's going to exchange it for his glory tonight. And so that you'll be able to say yes again. You'll be able to step into your destiny, the things that he has called for you. And it's going to be fun living with a yes. It's way more fun. It's boring living with no's. It is so boring. You know, if you say yes, you'll have some adventures. Some of them might be good lessons involved. But a lot of them are going to be major fruit bearing. And everything that even goes wrong, you learn from. Some of my greatest sermons are based on all my blunders, right? So just make it work for you. But I just want you to come forward. If you identify with that word that you lost your yes because of pain, because of discouragement, because you stepped out and it didn't turn out right, or because people have put you down, maybe even from childhood, come on forward because we're going to break that off of you so that your yes can return. And if you feel confident right now and your yes is big on the inside of you, I just speak the blessing of the Lord over you because your yes is about to enlarge even more. And the fruit of that yes is going to enlarge even more. Thank you, Lord. Debbie, there's such a fantastic call of God on your life. And you're going to step right into it because tonight's a turning point. This is a turnaround weekend for all of you. You don't have to go back the same. You're going to go with a yes. And when you're reading your word and God gives you a promise, don't think that that's for someone else. You say, yes, Lord, I'll take that. That's my promise. I'll take that. Yes, Lord. Just be a yes woman. Wild women are yes women, okay? They say yes to God. They say yes to his nudges. Praise the Lord. So when I come by, I'm just going to break off of you the hindrance. And when I lay hands on you, just come into agreement with it and seize that moment. Believe that it is done. Believe that it is done. And let the yes well up big on the inside of you. Because fear is going to get broken off of you tonight. Thank you, Jesus.
And how am I expected? Thank you. advocate.